Welcome to St. Mary's Harefield's streamed service for Sunday the 3rd of July, 2022, the feast day of Thomas the Apostle, the third Sunday after Trinity. Our opening hymn, How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds, was written by John Newton when he was rector of Olney in Buckinghamshire in 1779. He became more a bit rough and ready, as the expression goes, as he grew up. John Newton's mother died, in fact, when he was seven. And his father was a sea captain. At the age of 10, John Newton went to sea with his father. He ended up trafficking West African slaves. On one journey in a slave ship, there was a terrific storm, and the ship sprang a leak. It looked like it was going to sink. So John Newton cried out, "May the Lord have mercy upon us." It was the first prayer he'd uttered in years. Well, the ship was saved, and he began to think. He took his Bible and read and prayed, and John Newton became a new man. He gave up his seafaring life. He married in 1750 and became ordained into the Church of England. He served as curate of Olney in Buckinghamshire for 15 years, and during this time he wrote a number of hymns, including this one, How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds. In 1779, John Newton became the rector of St. Mary's, Woolnoth, Lombard Street in London, for 27 years. The church is close to the Royal Exchange in the Bank of England. His preaching attracted large crowds. After his death, he was laid to rest in the chapel vault of St. Mary's, Woolnoth. And a simple tablet to his memory was placed on the wall behind the pulpit, and it bears this inscription, written by himself: John Newton, Clerk, once an infidel and a libertine, a servant of slaves in Africa, by the rich mercy of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, preserved, restored, pardoned, and appointed to preach the faith he had long laboured to destroy. John Newton used to blaspheme the name of Jesus, but it became life-changing for him. How sweet the name of Jesus sounds in a believer's ear.
Thank you.
Let us pray. The collect for today for Thomas the Apostle. Almighty and eternal God, who for the firmer foundation of our faith allowed your holy Apostle Thomas to doubt the resurrection of your Son, till word and sight convinced him, grant to us who have not seen that we may also believe. Amen. We also pray, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. If you'd like to get hold of a piece of bread, we're going to be sharing some bread together later in the service. The Old Testament reading is from Habakkuk chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. The prophet Habakkuk is perplexed at the apparent triumph of evil. I will stand at my watch and station myself on the ramparts. I will look to see what he will say to me and what answer I am to give to this complaint. Then the Lord replied, write down the revelation and make it plain on tablets, so that a herald may run with it. For the revelation awaits an appointed time. It speaks of the end and will not prove false. Though it linger, wait for it. It will certainly come and will not delay. See, the enemy is puffed up. His desires are not upright, but the righteous person will live by his faithfulness. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The prophet Habakkuk sees how the Babylonian Empire is becoming the dominant world power and is successfully taking over more and more territory. Habakkuk is right to be concerned because Babylon does end up invading the kingdom of Judah and forcing the Jews into exile in 586 BC. Habakkuk is perplexed at the apparent triumph of evil and can't understand why God doesn't do something about it. He turns his worry into prayer and directly complains to God about the injustice of it all. He discerns God's response, and part of it contains these words. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. See, the enemy is puffed up. His desires are not upright, but the righteous person will live by his faithfulness. The particular focus of Habakkuk is very up to date, and so applicable in today's world, with the war in Ukraine being a constant backdrop to anything that goes on anywhere. See, the enemy is puffed up. His desires are not upright. These words from the 6th century BC could be directly applied to the aggression of Russia, Putin, Lavrov, and all who think they're so right in what they're doing in Ukraine. See, the enemy is puffed up. His desires are not upright. It's important to keep in mind the historical destiny of empires. They all eventually disappear, and they don't come back. See how mighty are the fallen, echo the pages of the history books. But when we're in the middle of witnessing evil, doing so much damage and taking so many innocent lives, this longer-term perspective might not be so immediately reassuring. Why do bad things happen to good people? Why does God allow dictators to wreak such havoc? Why do the innocent suffer? And why do the evil seem to get away with it? Why is Putin comfortably ensconced in the Kremlin? And why is he able to send missiles to target shopping centres and completely destroy thriving civilian towns and cities? It's more or less the same question that Habakkuk is asking in his context over 2,500 years ago. The difference is that the perceptive Habakkuk takes it directly to God, and then perceives the answer that God gives. There's a whole chapter containing God's response, but what are we told in this short section of the text that we've read today? There are certainly one or two things we can pick up on here. Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 3. For the revelation awaits an appointed time. It speaks of the end. It will not prove false. Though it linger, wait for it. It will certainly come and will not delay. Babylon will get its comeuppance, Its days are ultimately numbered. It might take a time, though. Babylon would rule the roost for half a century before Persia takes pole position. But the end of Babylon will come. It will be judged by a higher authority. That's the message. What doesn't come across in these verses, but it does in the whole text, and the larger message of the Bible, in fact, that Babylon will be used also to judge Judah. Judah seems to easily lose its godly roots. It's been up and down morally, ethically, and spiritually over its 400-year history. The Babylonian exile will cause it to question itself, to return to God, to find a stronger and better identity. For us, a time of crisis is often also a time of renewal. COVID will prove to be such. Our personal challenges will also produce some silver-lined benefits. Another thing about Habakkuk's message from God is that there's always something we can do. God uses the agency of people. In fact, we might even say he depends upon us, responding, taking our own responsibility seriously. We can, like Habakkuk, turn our worry into prayer. Habakkuk was told to write down what he was hearing, discerning, being told by God. Verse 2, "Then the Lord replied, 'Write down the revelation and make it plain on tablets, so that a herald may run with it.'" In Ukraine at the moment, people are recording things for the future prosecution of war crimes. It's really important to do this. War criminals have been successfully prosecuted from the American Civil War onwards. In our own time, we might think of Rwandan genocide, Yugoslavia, the so-called Islamic State in Syria and Iraq, amongst others. There have been the World War II Nuremberg trials in Syria and Iraq, and the Geneva Conventions. It's important to write things down to accurately record for the sake of justice being pursued and being done. One other little thing is communicated to the people, Prophet Habakkuk, rather, as he prays. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4, "But the righteous person will live by his faithfulness." Whatever's happening around us, and because of what's happening around us, we can make a personal response in exercising our faith and developing our faithfulness. This makes us fully alive, spiritually alive, and this can be maintained in the midst of oppression and difficulty. There is one fundamental thing I haven't mentioned so far. I suppose I've taken it for granted, but it's helpful to make a little note. We have free will. God has given us the power of choice. We're not puppets being manipulated. We're human beings who can make ethical choices for ourselves. Our free will makes us human, but it also guarantees the existence of bad behavior. In every generation, there will always be people who make wrong decisions and cause untold pain and suffering for others. Our next hymn or song, Down by the Riverside, is an African-American spiritual with its roots dating back to before the American Civil War. It's been used as an anti-war protest song, especially during the Vietnam War. The refrain, "Ain't Gonna Study War No More," is actually a reference to a Bible quotation found in the book of Isaiah chapter 2, verse 4. "Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more." It might be a useful song for us to engage with today in a world dominated by conflict. "I'm gonna lay down my heavy load down by the riverside. I ain't gonna study war no more."
I ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war.
Today's Gospel reading comes from the Gospel of John. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. It's John chapter 20, verses 24 to 31. Jesus appears to Thomas. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them, and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand, and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. The disciple and apostle Thomas introduces us to the challenge of doubt. He famously misses a meeting where the risen Jesus shows up, and then insists, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, Jesus shows up again, and Thomas is present, so of course he has his proof. But the message from the risen Jesus that rings down the ages to us today is this. John chapter 20 and verse 29. Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." So a question. What makes us believe in God? There can be a number of things that convince us of the existence of God. God, the creator of the universe, the creator of life, the creator of us. Maybe the miracle and wonder and complexity of life itself is enough to make us believe. There are also a number of things that can shake belief in God, which can cause people to doubt, to struggle with faith, to lose faith, to reject faith, to be a bit of a doubting Thomas, and maybe to give up on the church. But let me, for a moment, turn that question around. Rather than what makes us believe in God, what does belief in God make us? What difference does having faith make to us? What does Jesus say in John chapter 20, verse 29? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. There is something about having faith that is a blessing. We benefit in many ways. We have an anchor in life, a fixed point, as everything else seems to move around on the swell of the sea. We aren't alone if God is our divine companion. Life may take many things away from us, including people and our health, but nothing can take God away. We are loved by God. We can find forgiveness. We have hope through God, even beyond death. We can find joy and purpose, and life can be worth living. We also have the company of like-minded people if we're part of a church, a community of faith. It's been shown in many surveys and analysis that people who have faith are substantially better off than those who don't. We also, through the way we live, can be a blessing to others. Faith benefits those whose lives are touched by a person and who demonstrates it and lives it. Tradition has it the Apostle Thomas went to India to take the Christian faith there. The Martoma Church of India is named after him and is based in Kerala in India today. Augustine said that faith is to believe what we do not see, and that the reward of faith is to see what we believe. We can debate and argue till the cows come home as to whether belief in God is firmly founded or is based on more shaky ground. Faith is a blessing, not something onerous and unrealistic. I would guess that Thomas would discover this as he lived out his faith in the apostolic age. Faith only becomes real to us when we stop debating it and give it a go. The fact that it works may also point to the fact that it's true. The hymn, Blessed Are the Pure in Heart, was written by the Reverend John Keble as a poem in 1819. It became a hymn and was given the tune Franconia. The hymn is based on the words of Jesus in his Sermon on the Mount. Today, so much is about image, presenting a good image of ourselves to others. This is a healthy corrective, calling us to inward purity and a godly character. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see our God.
Thank you.
As we turn to our prayers, we're going to light a candle for Ukraine as we pray for the people today of that land. Let us pray. We pray for Ukraine in its continual suffering and for the growing exploitation of prisoners of war and civilians for political purposes. Lord, we put our trust in you. We pray for all those affected by the Afghanistan earthquake and the need for aid in order to help. Lord, we put our trust in you. We pray for the families of the migrants found dead in the Texas truck and for an end to all human trafficking. Lord, we put our trust in you. We pray for the concerning situation of the numbers of COVID cases rising in the UK again. Lord, we put our trust in you. We pray for Will and Alice as they prepare for their wedding at St. Mary's on Saturday. And we pray for those who are ill, for healing for those we know to be in need, especially Arlo, Andrew, Andrew Garner, Barbara Leake, Brenda Davis, Candy Hamlow, Carlene, Elaine Cantwell, Emma, Eunice Haswell, Gareth Williams, Gregory Ash, John Butler, John Smith, Lewin, Beryl Harold, Neil, Neil Osgood, Peter, Ruth Gookie, Pat Boobier, and any others we know. And we pray for those who grieve, for Dorothy Larkin, Martin Harold, Brian Adams, Denzel Peak, Lily Whitehead, Fred Hartley, and Rita and Derek Cummins, whose ashes were interred on Friday, and Kathleen Panrios, whose ashes will be interred today. Let us confess our sins to God. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. The hymn I Cannot Tell was written by William Fullerton in 1929. Fullerton was Irish. He became a Christian through the preaching of Charles Spurgeon, and then became a preacher himself. He set his hymn to the tune London Derriere, an old folk tune from Northern Ireland. The tune was first published in the Ancient Music of Ireland in 1855. It was much later, in 1910, that it came to be used for the ballad Danny Boy. It expresses the fact that the hope we have in Jesus contains many questions that we can't answer glibly. But it doesn't take away from the substance of our faith, which brings real hope to the whole world. I cannot tell.
I cannot tell why he whom angels worship should set his love upon the human race, or why as shepherd he should seek the wanderers to bring them back within the fold of grace. But this I know,
Savior.
We come to that point in the service when we're going to share some bread together. If you'd like to go and fetch your piece of bread, I'll go and fetch mine. So as an expression of all that unites us, as we join together in breaking this bread, in sharing it in our various locations, in finding unity despite our different places where we are situated, I'm going to hear a tune on the flute. St. Mary's Church is open this week to visit and for prayer and peace. Tomorrow, Monday from 10 till 2, Wednesday from 10 till 2, and Saturday from 10 till 1. There is a midweek service as usual this Wednesday at 10 a.m. in the Church Hall Chapel. And next Sunday, the services will be 8 o'clock communion and 10:30 communion in the church. There will also be a service streamed at 10:30. As usual next week. The hymn Beauty for Brokenness was written by the contemporary hymn writer Graham Kendrick in 1993. It was written, in fact, for the 25th anniversary of Tearfund, a Christian charity passionate about ending poverty. And Kendrick wrote the song after visiting India in 1992 and seeing the contrast between extreme poverty there and Western affluence. Beauty for brokenness, hope for despair. Lord, in the suffering, this is our prayer.
Beauty for brokenness, hope for despair. Lord, in the suffering, this is our prayer. Bread for the children, justice, joy, peace. Sunrise to sunset, your kingdom increase. Shelter for fragile lives, cure for their ills. Work for the craftsmen, trade for their skills. Land for the dispossessed, rights for the weak. Voices to plead the cause of those who can't speak. God of the poor, friend of the weak, give us compassion, we pray. Fall like rain. Come change our love from a spark to a flame. Refuge from cruel wars, havens from fear. Cities for sanctuary, freedoms to share. To the killing fields, scorched earth to green. Christ for the bitterness, his cross for the pain. God of the poor, friend of the weak, give us compassion, we pray. Melt our cold hearts, let tears fall like rain. Change our love from a spark to a ravaged earth, oceans and streams, plundered and poisoned, a future and dreams. Lord, end our madness, carelessness, greed, make us content with the things that we need. God of the poor, friend of the weak, give us compassion. Until the nations learn of your ways, seek your salvation and bring you their praise. God of the poor, friend of the weak, give us compassion.
So we end our service as usual with a poem, and we had one recently by this person who is Anne Bronte, the English novelist and poet, the youngest member of the Bronte literary family. Her mother died when she was just a year old, and Anne herself died when she was aged just 29, probably of pulmonary tuberculosis. She was the most pious of the Bronte sisters, and her poem, "My God, Oh Let Me Call Thee Mine," expresses how for her doubt was an integral part of her faith. It also describes the nature of true faith, which on the one hand clings on to God at all costs, on the other hand depends more upon God holding on to us. "My God, Oh Let Me Call Thee Mine," Anne Bronte, 1820 to 1849. "My God, Oh Let Me Call Thee Mine, weak wretched sinner though I be, my trembling soul would fain be thine. My feeble faith still clings to thee. My feeble faith still clings to thee. Not only for the past I grieve, the future fills me with dismay. Unless thou hasten to relieve, I know my heart will fall away. I know my heart will fall away. I cannot say my faith is strong. I dare not hope my love is great. But strength and love to thee belong. Oh, do not leave me desolate. Oh, do not leave me desolate. I know I owe my all to thee. Oh, take this heart I cannot give. Do thou my strength and saviour be, and make me to thy glory live, and make me to thy glory live." May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you today, this week, and always. Amen. The final hymn is "Fight the Good Fight," which was written by the Irish Anglican clergyman John Motzel in 1863. The hymn is based on a verse in the Bible from Paul's first epistle to Timothy, chapter 6 and verse 12, "Fight the good fight of faith, lay hold on eternal life." It reminds us of the fact that we live as Christians is sometimes a bit of a battle. The lyrics urge us to fight the good fight, lay hold on life, run the straight race, cast care aside, and faint not nor fear. Fight the good fight with all thy might. Christ is thy strength, and Christ thy right.
Fight the good fight.